Good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me all right? Is it working? Yeah, good. Excellent. Fine. Eric Schmidt made a statement, one other of his statements, last week, didn't he, about British education, said we weren't really doing it properly. Well, this is quite interesting. I think I'm beginning to believe that the guy's actually got it right. So this is what we do. We actually live just down the road there, just now down by the SSGB, and we're building the 1,000-mile-an-hour car, right? We're a very different sort of animal to what you might expect. We're in fact an aerospace company, and we're financed by sponsorship and also by public donation. That's what we are. We're no government involvement, no grants, etc., etc. We're just very different. Now, the interesting thing about us is that we have to innovate every day. You heard the guy talking earlier about innovation, an occasional innovation. We have to innovate every day because that is how we make our money. There are bigger, large organizations who want to use innovation, but actually a little bit worried about using themselves. So we're the people who come and help them out. So we build these amazing vehicles. And what I'm going to do now is show you some footage of Thrust SSC, which is our last car, breaking the sound barrier, the first time it was ever done on land. So let's just have a look. Back in 1997, we had a tremendous battle to achieve the first ever supersonic land speed record. We built a car called Thrust SSC, and you can see it in the museum there in Coventry, and it was the first one ever to break the sound barrier on land. We had a lot of trouble from the British establishment, who all said it couldn't be done, and it was going to be dangerous, and it was all going to end up in tears. But we pushed ahead, and we did it. We were up against the McLaren Formula One team. They gave up very early, and as you might, and we took them on, and we got it. So our land speed record was the first ever supersonic land speed record. And also it's very interesting too because it was done using computational fluid dynamics for the first time. Don't listen to the Formula One guys, we were the first people ever to design a car using CFD, computational fluid dynamics. There's an amazing picture here of the car actually breaking the sound barrier. And you can see the huge shockwave coming out the side. I'm a bit lost because of our video, but I'll plow on. And this is what the amazing response was. Now, we had a huge problem with the British media. The British media were saying to us during the build of that fantastic car, we can't give you much exposure, Richard, they would say, because basically our readers and our viewers won't understand this. It's far too complicated for them. And later on, I had a meeting with another organization, who better remain nameless, and they said, well, we have an unwritten rule within our organization that the mental age of our audience is 10, okay? And so we don't give them anything very complicated. And later on, we put up on our website 800 pages of technology, and the website hit these amazing numbers. Now, that's 1997, at a time, of course, when we had to dial up, didn't we? 59 million web visits, that's 300 million page views. Column kilometre of UK press coverage, 10 television documentaries, most famous car in the world, 50,000 people a year still come to see the car in the museum in Coventry and the web. Well, we gave up editing the web 13 years ago and it still runs 720,000 pages a year. Huge following. Okay, so let's move on. What actually happened was our good friends, the Americans, decided they were going to try and take our record off us. And Andy Green, who drove Thrust SSC and I, met in a pub. And we said, what are we going to do? Well, there are three options, one of which is to do nothing, second of which is to wait and see what the Americans do, and that'll take 5 years. Third is to go and do it right now and produce a Defender. So we said, we can't wait 5 years. We better get on with it, and we'll produce the ultimate car, absolutely the ultimate car. Now, the interesting thing is exactly the point about innovation is it's something that you pick up as you go. In other words, it's not directly as you organize it, it's as you get all these external influences and you realize you get opportunities. If you're an entrepreneur like we are, you have to live like that all the time. You're listening for opportunities and going out and grabbing them. Okay, so we move on, and that's what we wanted, a Eurofighter engine. It's the most advanced gas turbine engine in the world. It powers the Eurofighter. It is very light, it's got a small cross-sectional area, it's very fuel efficient, exactly what we want. It's not powerful enough to drive the whole car, but certainly that's what we want. We had a meeting with Lord Drayson. Drayson was the minister responsible for defence equipment and support. We had a very friendly meeting with him until I asked him the question. I said, Minister, we need an EJ200 Eurofighter engine. There was a terrible silence, and it all went wrong. And the minister had no intention of letting us have one of these engines. And so basically that looked like the end of our, certainly the end of our meeting and probably the end of our project. We were just about to leave the minister when he said, hang on a moment, he said, got a bit of a problem, you guys can help me. So I said, yeah, of course, Minister, what can we do? And he said, see, the biggest, we've got two problems in the Minister of Defence. One is called the Treasury, and the other is a shortage of engineers. We can't recruit engineers because there aren't any engineers. So he said, I've had a sort of think about all this. He said, and I think we should go back to the 1960s, the old Cold War, when Britain produced these fantastic aeroplanes. Quite a lot of them were produced around here, of course, in Bristol. And he said, during that time, there was a new aeroplane every year. All the kids in the schools, etc., were really fired up about it. Everybody wanted to be engineers or scientists or pilots. That's what we've got to go back to, he said. So what I want is an iconic project run through every school to stimulate a new generation of engineers. Now, I knew, and Andy knew, that as a result of our land speed records, and we've held that world record now for 27 years, we knew that it had created a lot of engineers. We've got no data, of course, but it's purely circumstantial, but we knew that it created engineers. So this might work. And then I thought, you're in front of the minister, you won't get back there again in a hurry, so you better do something. So I stood up and I shook the guy's hand and I said, we'll do it. He was absolutely appalled. And all he could say to me was, I'm not giving you any money, which was a very odd response, but anyhow, there you go. And so I said, I don't care a damn, we'll bloody well go and do it. We walked out and we left him with his mouth open. Right, okay, so now we better study something about engineering, about education, because if we're going to build this car and we're going to get our jet engine, we better understand how all this works. So let's get going. We know nothing about education. Okay, what's happening in our country? There's our Lord Leach's report of 2005. All the skills are in the 40 to 60-year-old age in the companies. The aerospace industry is in terrible problems. Over the next 20 years, they'll lose 60% of their skilled workforce. Something has gone wrong in this place. That's IT professional skills. The magenta line on the top is basically the population of IT professionals, and the blue line is people applying for computing courses. Something has gone wrong. PISA, Program for International Student Assessment. Where we were in 2000 was 8th, 4th, and 4th, and now we're 17th, 24th, and 14th. We're just not hacking it. I mean, there's something seriously wrong. We should be up the top. It's a fantastic nation, this. It's capable of doing all sorts of things. But we started asking the teachers, what's it like? And they say, teaching STEM is difficult. STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics. It's difficult. The kids aren't interested. They ask questions like, why do we need mathematics? As long as I can add and subtract and do a bit of simple multiplication and the occasional, why do we need it? Is STEM a dead language like Latin and Greek? Well, certainly the teachers are getting that. Nothing exciting is going on in Britain. So we then said to teachers, okay, well, what do you want? What we want is an exciting science and engineering project which we can follow day by day as it happens. There isn't anything exciting going on in Britain, and you can't excite the kids with wind turbines or electric cars. We move on. There is hope because an amazing thing happened. Right, okay, so this is 1900 to 2006, and it's the conferring of PhDs in the US, right? And you can see it sort of trots along the bottom until something starts to happen at 1962, and it climbs like Topsy. What was it? It was the manned space program. So if you can get a really exciting program that gets them all excited and worked up, then you can change the place. Now, it's very interesting. We're sponsored by Intel, and occasionally we meet up with sort of senior executives at NASA, because they're all fascinated by what we're doing. We always show them that graph, and they say, God, did we do that? He said, yeah, you changed your nation. That's what you did. America was a bit of a basket case in the 1960s. But, guys, that enabled the development of the huge IT industry. You can do these things. Okay, so we began to learn. We got an education team together, and we started going around all the schools. And it took us a long time to understand what was actually happening. So here, basically, is what it's about. It's about inspiration. So on the y-axis, on the vertical axis, is your level of inspiration, and basically that's your age, if you like, your school age along the bottom on the x-axis. And what we found is the conventional thing is this, that basically kids go to school and somewhere along the line they rub up against engineering or science or something, and they might show a bit of interest. It just sort of trundles along, and with a bit of luck they might just show some interest. What we discovered with Bloodhound, which is our new car, is they get interested at the age of 5. And you can hold that interest all the way through their educational period. So this starts to get really interesting. We've got 1.5 million school kids on this thing. So it's rather frightening, actually. Anyhow, there we go. What's happening in education? We've got the kids are doing 30 hours a week in school, and they're doing 45 hours a week on their computers. And so if you study things like the Khan Academy, you'll discover that actually they prefer to learn from online. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to be doing our online education as well, of course, as doing the UK education. And that's our educational policy as far as this project's concerned. We're going to make all the data available on the project. So, for instance, all the CAD drawings on the car are up there on the web, and you can go and pull them down. 2,400 downloads so far, you know. We're making all the performance data available. But, of course, the problem is, if we're going to make all that data available, we've actually got to educate people so they can understand the data. We're talking about huge scale here. So we're doing, with Southampton University, our own online academy here. We're not going to patent anything, and Bloodhound is now in 211 countries. Okay, so what's going on down the road then? Let's have a look. We're moving towards a hypersonic vehicle, a car. Now, the wonderful thing about a car is everybody's got a car, and they understand what a car is. Not everybody's got an airplane, not everybody's got a boat, but a car, they do. They understand that, right? Driving a car in a straight line, straightforward stuff, everybody can do that. So, you know, people can understand what we're trying to do here. Our gold car, Thrust 2, did Mach 0.85. I drove that and to within 7 miles an hour of takeoff, so I'm very glad to be here. Andy Green drove Thrust SSC to Mach 1.03, and now we're going to Mach 1.4. Here's our performance curve, and the car is going to, all this happens in 100 seconds, and it happens over 10 miles, and the car is going to go 1,050 miles an hour through the measured mile. We're going to cover a measured mile in 3.6 seconds. Okay, and we've got acceleration of 3G, which is space shuttle stuff, so very comfortable, very easy. 3G is 0 to 66 in 1 second, 0 to 132 in 2. It's easy stuff. And deceleration down the other end, which again is 3G, so it's more or less a symmetrical curve. Covering 4.5 football pitches per second, all right, at the top. And when I drove my car, 2G acceleration, 6G deceleration, so Andy's got it easy. Right, okay. The design of a car like this is an absolute nightmare. What do? We got basically a grant from the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, which went into our friend Swansea Universities, who are a specialist on computational fluid dynamics. That gave us a 5-man team. We had to put together a 17-man team to start designing the car. We don't know what we're doing. Nobody can help us. The Formula One people are slow. You know, that's no good. Aerospace industry don't do vehicles that move along the ground, so they can't help us. You're out on your own. So what we've got to do is design what we think is right to a high standard, make sure the shape includes all the components that have got to go into it, surface it to a high standard, send it off to Swansea, and basically they do the CFD on it. I've got 5 minutes, so we ought to move quickly. they do the CFD on it, and the result of which is awful. So we go through all these different cycles, and finally, with Hewlett-Packard and with Rolls-Royce, we finally got it last year. Right. And we're operating in South Africa, where we've been given a desert called the Hexking Pan. We've also got the government on board, and here we have our team there on the desert, removing 24 million square meters of stones. We'll have it clear by the end of the year. The education machine is fantastic. We've got 4,600 schools on this now. The kids are all building rocket cars. They're building balloon cars. They've done 25,000 balloon cars. The primary schools, very important, 2,400 of them. All sorts of people are involved. That's Andy on the right. Neil Armstrong turns up from time to time, and down there in Bristol, just down the road, we've got a full-scale model of the car. The car is constantly on the move. We're really booked up into 2012 now, and that's a summary of it. We've got 38 people working. We're funded by sponsorship and public donation. Every day, between 300 and 1,000 quid comes in. No capital, no investment. We don't want to get involved in those awful city people. We're revenue-driven. 42% of the entire budget's done. I've spent about 5.4 million. We've done 30 man years of research. We've got the design together. We're going to roll out in December. We're going to be operational in 2013 and 2014. And all that data is going to be available, so you can follow it. And the web capacity is 5 billion page views per annum. That's it. Thank you.